with Phyllis Everett. You are, I was just thinking about this last night, you are an angel on earth. And I don't know if you know that. You are an angel on earth. That's how I see you. And we're going to find out why I'm saying that about you and who you are. So let's just jump right in there. Your name is Phyllis Everett.
Yes, it is.
Tell us a little bit about you. Let's tell us a little bit about you, and then we'll talk about the organization you founded. Tell us who you are.
I am Phyllis Everett, CEO and founder of Saffron Trust Women's Foundation. But who I am is really an African-American woman who was born into poverty. My mother was orphaned when she was 2 years old. Mm. Her mother died at 24 years old at the Tampa Negro Hospital, leaving my mother and my two uncles orphaned. And so I was raised by a woman named Dorothy Ballard. Mm. She had 10 children. I'm number 6 in line.
Wow.
Yeah, number 6. Yeah. My mother, there were a lot of issues, mental health issues, obviously, being orphaned and being a little girl having to be raised without a mother had to be traumatic, especially back at that time. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of the attention that was required, not so much that a lot of things happened to me, but things that should have occurred for a normal little black girl probably didn't happen for me, the kind of love and attention that I needed. So I grew up with a heavy dependency, emotional dependency need. Mm. And so having friends was important. Being a good friend was important. Mm-hmm. Loving my siblings was extremely important. And having a very strong family value became very important for me. And as that became important growing up, I valued my friendships. My friends have been my friends for decades. Mm. I'm loyal to a T. I'm the best friend that most women look to have, and the sister that every sister deserves.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
The best friend and the loyal sister.
And the loyal sister. Yeah.
You said you were one of 10.
One of 10, number 6.
Number 6. What number was that six. Like? And where did you say this was again? Where'd you grow up?
I grew up in Long Island, New York City.
What is that like, being one of 10 children?
Oh my gosh, a lot of fun.
Yeah.
You have the older siblings who kind of dictate what you should and shouldn't do. And then I had, I was number 6, so I had 5 under me that I tormented as well. my younger brother, Scotty, he's actually a pilot, but he was afraid of mannequins.
Yeah. And you would scare him.
And I was scared with mannequins. I was like, well, mom goes to work. If you don't treat me right, I would take the little mannequins and he'd be running around the house. And my younger sister, June, who's one of my best friends as well, you know, I was always telling her what to do and, you know, punishing her as well. Mm. And then the oldest ones punished me.
Of course.
Yeah.
I was going to ask you about alliances. When I only had 3 brothers and sisters, but you tend to form alliances.
Yes.
With which one of your siblings did you form alliances with?
Wow. Probably my brother Ernest, because we were the same age.
Yeah.
And so we went to school together. So my mom had us 2-2-2-2-2 like that. And so my brother Ernest, his nickname is Butch. I formed a very strong alliance with him growing up because we had the same friends and we went to the same high school. So,
yes.
Yeah.
You are the founder of an organization that you mentioned before.
Yes.
Tell us about your organization and what it does.
Well, the organization is called Saffron Trust Women's Foundation. And what we do is we look to bring those characters that I said I grew up with, right, being a best friend and being a sister, we try to bring that same model into the work that we're doing. And it's very simple for me because that's the core and the fabric of who I am. And so we have what's called a solid ground program, and we really want women to become solid, right? Mm-hmm. And solid takes a lot of different components. It's not getting your rent paid. It's not just getting food supplements. It's not getting a new car. It's a combination of many things that come together. And solid ground was formed because When I was in my 20s, I was married. Mm-hmm. I had three children, and I was a battered wife. My husband was very abusive, and
Where was this?
Was in the Bronx. At that time, I had moved from Long Island, which is the suburbs of New York, mm-hmm. to the Bronx. Mm-hmm. And we moved into a shelter for battered women. Mm. There was a home that someone had donated, a huge brownstone, and there may have been four other families in it with me. And the sisterhood became extremely important. Mm. We all supported one another. And although it was a very dark time for me, it was a very powerful time, and it helped unfold into something that we actually implement in Saffron Trust today. And when I'm running Saffron Trust and helping women get on their feet, mm-hmm. I go back to what I learned decades ago. And I recall, as my children and I were trying to get on our feet, there was a lot of support around us, but every time we went to get support, we were traumatized all over again.
We're gonna talk about that, because we talked about that over the phone, and I left that conversation with you on the phone.
Yes.
Just sort of sad, mm-hmm. and like enlightened about things that I never thought about with regard to growing up poor, which a lot of kids do. I want to talk to you about that. I want to back up a little bit, though. I want to say that your organization, yes. Saffron Trust,
yes.
helps women.
Yes.
We want to make that clear.
Yes, it does.
So you help. Tell us a little bit more about how your organization helps women in the Austin area.
So once they come into us, we do like a biopsy or a report card. And so every woman is different. And so depending on what they need, we want to make it that central source where they don't have to connect with individuals. They don't have to wait 2 to 3 weeks to get food supplements. They don't have to wait 6 months to be on a rent. And they don't have to be re-traumatized, nor do their children, by sharing their story over and over and over again with that central point,
yes.
right, that does the care coordination services. So once they come into us, we automatically do those services that, and it's catered to them individually what they need. And also, while we're doing that, we're doing civic engagement, we're socializing. We
yes.
have many different programs within Saffron Trust.
Yes.
We partner with Dr. Ebony Butler, and we do the Heart for the Arts.
We're going to talk about that, but I don't want to skip over this, because this is important to me. This, it makes me angry.
Yes.
I would imagine that people who watch this episode,
yes.
many of them have no idea, when we talk about being battered,
yes.
when we talk about living in shelters,
yes.
when we talk about living in poverty with your kids, when we talk about having to go to apply for food stamps, WIC,
yes.
for many people have no idea what that's like. And it's not a judgment against them. It's not their fault that they're born into privilege or born, you know, with two parents, being raised with two parents who
yes.
are working together. It's a wonderful thing to grow up in a home where the husband's not battering the wife.
Yes.
That is what we all should want.
Yes.
But many people have no idea what that's like. I want them to understand what it's like.
Mm-hmm.
When you were being battered, you had how many kids at the time?
Three children.
What did that feel like?
It felt frightening.
Yeah.
It felt frightening because I didn't know if people would understand me. And you carry a sense of shame with you.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
You have these three children. And people are looking at you as though, you know, you're never going to be anything, right?
Yeah.
We have to help you. You need a handout. And so it's a very hard thing to carry, right? Mm. And then you do things that you wouldn't normally do because you're in fear for your life. I remember I had to go for a job interview in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually took my three children, and I don't know if you can envision this, and I packed peanut butter sandwiches for them. My son was 7, my daughter was just months old, and one was a year.
Mm.
And I left them in the middle of Grand Central Station on a bench with a peanut butter sandwich and tangerine. And I told my son, don't let anybody come near you. Don't let anybody talk to you. Make sure you watch your two sisters. And as I walked away, I said, Mommy has to go get a job. I have to go for this interview. There's no one to keep you. I remember my feet felt like they were lead. They were made out of lead. Mm. Because as I was walking, I was like, I cannot leave these children alone. What happens if someone kidnaps them? And I remember going to the interview up the elevator. And after the interview was over, I rushed through it. I remember running through Grant. I was sweating, running in my sneakers, you know, thinking about my children and what I had done. It sounds so harsh, you know. And had anyone saw that, I probably would have been a poster woman of, you know, children that were neglected.
Yeah. And yet, yes, you're right. It does. Mean, it's shocking. And yet, what other choice?
What other choice did I have?
What choice do you have when you have to support your children?
I didn't have a choice.
You have to go to the job interview.
I had to go to the job interview.
And if you don't have the support you need, what do you do? Now, your kids, grown today, they're well. You are a phenomenal mama. But thank you for sharing that kind. This is the thing I'm saying. It's like, it's so easy for someone on the outside to judge a mother who would do that without thinking, why? What is going on in that woman's life?
Why?
You are just as much a mother as any other woman who has every resource that she needs.
Yes.
You just have to do things that she might not do. But you have that connection to your kids as much as she has to hers.
Yes, I did.
That is what I want people to understand, that when we talk about statistics, you know, we pull these numbers out, and I think many of us, they just go over our heads anymore. I do want to give one statistic, though.
Is it like 74,000 out of 444,000 families?
The poverty rate for women, we're talking about women who live in Austin, Texas, is 16%.
Yes.
And I imagine in my mind that it might be higher than that, so that's a good thing, but 16% is 16% still.
Yes.
Round up 17%, 16.7%. 74,000 out of 444,000 families in Austin live below the poverty line.
Yes.
Now that's a number, 74,000. That's 74,000 families.
I know.
Families.
I know.
Who are living below the poverty line. And what does that mean? So if you're living below the poverty line, what does life look like for a family like that?
Hard. Hard. And harder. And harder. If you look at a mother and she has two teenage daughters, when we talk about hygiene products alone, right? If you're living below the poverty line, the average salary, $16, $17, $20, how do you even afford an extra $200 a month for two teenage girls for hygiene products? And so we're talking about an extra maybe $1,200 a year. It can take me 2 years to save an extra $1,200.
Right.
And so children are missing school, right? Girls every month, a week, or depending on how heavy their cycle is, because there's not enough funding to go around for normal items that people who don't have to think about that effortlessly have.
Yes. This is something we don't think about.
No,
we don't think I've ever thought about a family living in poverty with teenage girls
with
and their hygiene products and how that might keep them from going to school, which I get.
Yeah, yeah. I was in a meeting and I had a mom. I went to the child study team with the mom, and the child had to be dropped off at a certain time because the child was having issues being on the bus. And the mom had worked at a bank downtown, and she had to be to bank. She had to be to work at 8 o'clock. But just traveling Mopac on the express lane is like an extra $8 a day.
Yes. Yeah.
Just for her to get to work on time. And can you imagine the mother driving, the stress, the allostatic load that's being placed upon her, right? Every day. And then before you know it, she's 40, 45, high blood pressure, diabetes, because the stressors never turn off. They are on continuously every day, all day.
It's chronic.
Chronic.
Yeah.
And then you're like, well, why isn't she going to the parent teachers meeting? Why isn't she involved in advocacy? Parents need to be learning, understanding. Are you kidding me? I don't think there's a parent on the face of the earth that loved their children more than I loved my children.
Of course. Of course. Yeah. And how dare anyone judge that, having not experienced that? We've got to stop.
They judge it all the time.
Right.
You know, you have to get out and vote. Well, the first time I voted was when Barack Obama was in office.
Yeah.
I didn't have time to politically understand the strongholds that were put on me and my community.
Yeah.
I didn't have time to really understand the political ramifications, right? Because my children were traumatized by so many other things. They needed mommy. They had to come in from school. Mommy had to talk to them. I had to drive an hour home. I had to worry about milk and eggs and putting tires on the car and, you know, having someone that I needed to lean on. It's like, you know, we're both on a ship. So we have those who are fortunate on a ship, and you have those who are less fortunate on the ship with holes in it. And we take off at the same time. But our ship, we're always trying to get the water, you know, to plug the holes, right? And their ship is just gliding to the other. We want to get to the same destination. We have the same children. We want to get to the same goal. But our boat started out with holes in it, and we're trying to plug it, you know. So, you know, their boat, you know, dinner time, they have chefs on it. You know, dinner time, I got to get the help. You guys got to get this water out the ship so we can make it there. And so their ship is just gliding along. Ours is falling behind because we're plugging the holes and we're trying to keep the ship afloat.
Yeah.
But the dreams and the desire, we start out the same. We're no different.
Yeah.
So if it's the same equity, we could reach it at the same time. The one thing that Saffron Trust doesn't want to do is repeat what happened to me. And so just getting support took a long time, and it was a lot of effort, and taking the children with me everywhere I went to tell the story over and over again, to go get housing. Well, Miss Everett, what happened? Where's the father? So you were batted. And the children sat there and listened to it over and over again. I would go to get food supplement. Same story all over again. Childcare, same story all over again. And it was a period of time before that kind of relief even came because the waiting list was so long. At Saffron Trust, you tell your story one time. You do not have to repeat it. And what took me years ago, maybe 6 months or a year to get relief, we tried to minimize that by having the support a woman needs in a matter of weeks, if not days. I mean, once they come onto our system, the partnerships that we have with are in the system takes 24 hours to get back to them. And we're constantly picking up the phone to talk to these women. And not only are they getting the services, guess what? They're going to the opera with us. Their children are sitting on the front row. They're at the Austin Ballet, right? And so we're doing all these things together.
And you partner with local groups and affiliations to make those things happen.
Yes, because all those things make a difference.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
All those things make a difference in a woman's life. And what changes a woman is the experience. What changes a child's life is the experience.
Yeah. Yeah.
You from Fort Worth?
Kind of disorder.
Oh, okay, kind of disorder. Yeah.
Worked in Washington, on the Capitol with congressmen. Knows the laws.
That's why she's not nervous.
We're all nervous. We try to do our business. I mean, we struggle all as black women. And that's what me and Charlotte.
She being nervous in this room with this camera.
No, I mean, this is what greatness looks like.
My name is Courtney Jones, and I am 38 years old.
My name is Lachey Cairo. I'm 35 years old.
My name is Barbara James. I am 63 years old.
I have two children, one boy, one girl.
I have two boys, 15 and 16 years old.
I had two boys. My oldest son, unfortunately, was murdered in 2006. He was 28. And I have one son left, Bryson, who will be 35 next month. I've always been a good mother, period. And I love my boys. They have always been my everything. And my grandchildren now, I carry that on. I have five beautiful, awesome, talented, just beautiful grandchildren, two boys and three girls, and I love them with my whole heart.
I was run into roadblock after roadblock after roadblock with agencies that said they could help people in my particular situation. And I was couch surfing for a minute, and I finally got an apartment and finally got a job, and I was trying to take care of me and my two kids. So I fell behind in my rent, and I didn't know what to do. I had a note on my door that if I didn't pay my rent, that I would be evicted. And when I met Miss Phyllis, and she told me she had a program that could help me for a year pay my rent, I was so thankful because I had just got that notice on my door. And I was just like, God, I need a break. And she was my break. She was my help.
I admire them. I admire their strength. And me personally, I always think I'm just so old and that I should be so far ahead of where I am. And then I see two beautiful young ladies, but then I can say, I still got it. I still got something. I don't know what it is, but I'm gonna hold on to it. But I'm proud of these two. I really am. And I'm 63. I'll be 64 next month, but I'm still rising every morning.
Still younger than my grandparents.
Generational curses is a lot. Yeah. So you might not have nothing handed down to you to where Sarah and Julie did. Yeah. They got a head start, but they don't know what to do with it. Yeah. And so we all in it together.
Each and every day that we wake up, we're blessed with God's mercy and grace. And so when you wake up every day, you know, be the best version of yourself that you can be. And just know that you're not in competition with anybody but yourself. And so when you have goals, you just keep striving for what those goals are. And there's no age limit on goals. You know, there's no age limit on dreams. You know, as long as you keep plugging away at your dreams and your goals, it doesn't matter what age you are.
Where is the most memorable place you've been?
I would say Washington, D.C. is probably the most memorable place I've been. I moved to Washington, D.C. a couple years ago to do an internship for former foster youth, and that allowed me to be exposed to Congress, and that's something that I will forever remember.
That's real easy, is Florida. When I turned 30 years old, me and my boys went to Orlando, Florida to actually go to Walt Disney World. We had super fun.
It would probably have to be Houston, Texas, or Atlanta, Georgia, because in both those cities, I was a lot younger, and both my boys were with me.
When I was a little girl, I wanted to be an attorney.
Oh, that's easy too. I want to be a doctor.
When I was a little girl, I think I took my first flight. I was 7 years old, and I flew from Texas to California and went to Disneyland. And at that point, I decided I wanted to be an airline stewardess or hostess or flight attendant, as they call it now.
I think maybe my favorite meal is enchiladas. Chicken enchiladas. It's the only thing I really know how to make really well.
My favorite food is Mexican food, but my favorite meal with Mexican food is, you know, beans, rice, and tacos.
Chicken fried steak, mashed potatoes, and green beans with some peach cobbler on the side or cake.
My best physical feature is my smile.
My smile. Yes, I love my smile.
Probably my eyes and my smile.
Can we see a smile?
I I'm not a statistic.
I'm easygoing. I think when people see me, they see me as kind of like a threat. I pray, and so when God show me the way, sometimes I guess certain situations make me stronger, and so I carry all the bags on me, but it's not to initially to come off, I'm this, I'm that, but it's just when I come in the room, I'm handling so much that I come in the room and I stop and I take a breath, and I think that's in the motion of all that, people see that.
I'm a person who cares deeply. I love hard, I care deeply, and I don't like to see anyone hurt. The loss of my son was tremendous, and it breaks my heart now to look at the news every single day, all night, young men getting killed, whatever, whatever. My son was murdered. So I want people to know that I have such a soft heart. I have a sweet spirit. I have a caring spirit. And God is my provider. And I just want everybody to know that I'm human. I've made mistakes, I've gone through battles, but I've overcome so much. And I want everybody to know that they can do it too. If I can, they can.
So the women that you help, what are they like?
Oh my God, they're so amazing. Mm-hmm. They're powerful. They have dreams. They have vision. There's actually one woman, and she actually worked for a couple of congressmen in Washington, D.C.
Wow.
And a mishap came up on her record, and she lost her job. And she has three beautiful children, and she's finished college, and she's very well educated. I have another woman. She has a beauty salon. She has two sons. Mm-hmm. Her husband was murdered. I mean, just amazing. Yeah. Dreams and aspire to be great and just want the things that they see everyone else have. I found out, I think I was about 40 years old, I was rushed to the hospital. And I didn't know what was wrong, and you know, I went to the emergency room, and they told me that I had high blood pressure. And I was like, I work out every day, I drink water, I don't eat red meats. How could I? It's not hereditary in my family. He said, but the stress is over time. It's like a drip in, it's, you know, a bucket. It's, yes. Once it gets filled up, it just, if there's a leak in your ceiling, that last drop will just overflow it. And being African American, always trying to prove myself at work, meeting things because I only, you know, they were trying to fill a quota, right?
Yeah.
And raising children alone and dealing with the emotions of the children who didn't have a father around.
Yes, yes.
And all of that. It just, and so I have high blood pressure. And that high blood pressure has affected the social determinants of health for me,
yeah.
Right? Because diabetes is next. I mean, all those things. And so I'm not exempt from it. And so these systems that are put in place affect the social determinants of health. Mm. And at Saffron Trust Women's Foundation, our ultimate goal is to decrease the social determinants of health so that a woman can thrive, strive, live healthy, right? And have that impact in her children. So we're looking to stop it at her, and maybe we may not be able to impact some of the determinants of health that have already affected her, but they will make a difference in her children and her children's children.
Yes.
And so I always say that when you look at Phyllis Everett, I am that picture, right? Mm-hmm. There are some of the things that impacted me, but as I began to change them and as I began to become more educated about some of the things that were affecting my health and my community and the zip code I lived in, mm-hmm. what should have been a normal, you know, I always say my children, you know, they should have been in jail. My son should have been a gangbanger. My daughter should have, you know, children out of wedlock. But because there were individuals that cared about me and things changed in my life, it changed in their life too. And as they change, they become advocates for their community.
Yes.
And so it really changes generationally.
Something else you talked about that I thought about on our phone call.
Mm-hmm.
You talked with, so I love the idea of taking risks.
Yes.
Right? Who doesn't love the idea of taking risks? You know, right now everyone loves Elon Musk because he's a risk taker. He's a maverick. Okay. I think many of us have that in us.
Yes.
But you talked to me about something called play equity.
Oh, yes.
Which I thought, I didn't think about that either. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Well, play equity is living in a community where you have the ability to play freely, to go into your community garden or your, what do you call it, where the children go play,
the
playground.
Playscape.
But yeah, and do the things that you want to do. And children that live in communities where that's not afforded to them, their children, their parents are afraid for them to go into the park. So we lived in the Bronx. And I called my daughter. She said, yeah, Mom, you never let us play in the park because we were afraid of the crack valves or the drug addicts that were there. And, you know, you never let us walk to the park. And I was like, I did that. And she goes, yeah, which is why we were so fearful. Yeah. We were afraid of everything.
Yes.
We were afraid to play. And not only that, in our communities, if your children get a scrape, I was always afraid for my children to get a cut because that stigma of being a black woman with three children, if they got a cut or something, it was like, there, you know, child welfare is right there. You did something. And, you know, I never let my kids go to the park or play. And so play equity is very important for the child to be creative, to have a mind.
Yes.
You know, to climb Mount Kilimanjaro or jump out of a parachute. Or,
exactly.
But we don't want to do those things because child play equity is not, our children don't want to do those things.
That
and
really
so they
resonated.
Grow up very fearful. It doesn't really,
resonated with me. That is a reality that
it's
a lot
reality.
Of parents of color, and particularly black parents, feel. You are not safe. You need to be with me. Mm-hmm. So if you're a child and you grow up with that mindset where you weren't able to go, you weren't able to really sort of like Indiana Jones and,
right?
and you know go out and inspect your neighborhood, you take that with you as an adult. And so you tend to live very safe lives.
Contained.
Which
safe.
Means then, no, we can't all be out there Elon Musking. We have the potential, but we have been conditioned to know we better hang back because of whatever. Doesn't mean we don't have that potential.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think Dr. Ebony Butler said, she does Holding Hope, which is a workshop we have, and she said that in the black, in our culture, we live more of the probability, the possibility, not the probability. And so, you know, I'm like, Charlotte, let's fly to Paris. And you're like, Phyllis, but girl, I don't want to be up there. You know, there was a 747 that crashed and I just can't do that.
Exactly.
But the probability of that really happening to us. And so we live off the possibility and we create the possibility as a reality. And we live in fear. And so we never do it.
What was it that helped you get out of poverty?
Wow. Well, you know, I wind up, when I was about 30 years old, working for TLC Beatrice, which is run by Reginald Lewis. Mm-hmm. Reginald Lewis is the guy who created the book. He wrote the book, Why Should White Guys Have All the Fun. He had the biggest merger back then with, was it Nabisco? And so he acquired them, and I wind up working for his company. He was deceased, but his wife, Loida Lewis, ran the company, and his brother, Gene Fugit. And so I worked with them. And that was the first time I had been around African Americans who were so wealthy. Yeah. Oh my gosh. And I remember during Take Your Daughter to Work Day, Christina Lewis and her sister and someone else took my daughter out. And my daughter, Miss Charlene, walked into the penthouse and they were serving her water in Cristal.
Oh no.
And she's like, who drinks water in Cristal? Like, we were from the Bronx, right? And so she's like, oh my God, black people live like this. And so it transformed my whole way of living and thinking to be in that environment. And they were so loving. Loida Lewis is an amazing woman. And she treated everybody with such kindness. And so that was the first time I had been introduced to people like that. I was like in my 30s. And I remember they had a big event, and all of the black celebrities came, and I believe, I don't know who was there, Malcolm X's wife, Betty Shabazz, Martin Luther King's wife, and so it was a many of them came together, and so that changed trajectory of the direction I was going in, and I was like, wow, you know, we do these things, and then I worked for Dennis Swanson at NBC Sports, and the Metropolitan Opera House was across the street, and I had a girlfriend that worked there, and I started taking the children to dress rehearsals.
Oh, that's always good.
And so and then Beethoven in the Park, and New York is really artsy anyway.
Yes.
And so I became a real arts advocate at that time, and so did my children. And my children are grown, but they will fly all over the world to go see.
This is why we need more attention put yeah. on in schools. In the yeah. arts. Like, the do arts. Not take the arts away.
Do not take the arts away.
That's life-changing.
Oh, that's life-changing. And Saffron Trust is a big advocate for the arts now.
That's what I was getting at. So some of your sponsors, and I'm Austin Opera.
Austin Opera, yes.
Joyce James is listed here. Again, you need to know about Joyce James.
Yes.
But, and there are others, St. David's, Hogg Foundation for Mental Health, the city. Yes. But I really, Jack Allen's Kitchen.
Yes.
I really loved seeing Austin Opera there because you were talking about some of the things you do.
Yes.
Tell us.
Well, we started out, I want to give kudos to the Austin Ballet, Stephen. He's the director there. And I think I was taking Leadership Austin or Courageous Conversation when I met him. And we had lunch. And he said, Phyllis, what can I do? I said, well, let's have lunch. And I went to the ballet. And I said, how many people in the community that live 5 miles away sit in these seats? He said, not many. He said, what do you want? I said, tickets to all the shows. And he said, you got it. And so we're part of the community night. Yes. And to see the children sitting in the front row watching the Nutcracker.
Yes.
And all the different performances. And it's been 3 years now. So it's the Austin Ballet, the Opera House, Zach Performing Arts, the Long Center we've partnered with. And there's one more I can't think of right now. But yeah, all the performances.
But what you're doing is the women who you are helping to connect to resources to help them and pull them from poverty.
Yes.
One of the things you do working with these organizations that you partner with is you have tickets for these kids to go see this art.
Yes,
the art. Can change that can change everything for them.
Yes.
Everything.
Everything. And in the last performance at the Austin Opera House, they had a performance set up. They had the performance set up for two nights, but they also did a virtual training. So the week before the show, they got on with the children and the moms to tell them what the storyline was about.
Mm.
So they can actually follow the whole show through, and it made such a difference. So yeah, it's pretty exciting. It's pretty exciting.
Well, I love that I know you, and I appreciate so much what you do. Poverty. You know, if it's heartbreaking, it's heartbreaking that we know, and we always say, you know, America has enough resources for everybody. And yet we know that there are children who go to sleep hungry. We know that there are children who are in, situations that are not setting them up for the future.
No.
And it's just heartbreaking.
It's heartbreaking. I tell people all the time, you know, we talk about the social determinants of health. And when I moved to Austin, I found out that 1 in 4 families in Travis County was food insecure. And I learned about food deserts and food swamps and all these different things that I didn't know anything about. And you think about families that they're moving, doing gentrification, and there's more than two miles to the biggest supermarket. So they have to go to the store. And you have Hawaiian Punch, you know, 64 ounces for $2.69, but you know, a small 13 ounce bottle of water with alkaline is like $3, and you have a mother of three, what is she gonna buy?
Right.
You know, and what are the kids gonna be accustomed to? They're accustomed to, you know, the Hi-C and the Kool-Aid, which same, my children were too.
Yeah.
And that's how I filled up my house, you know, with Kool-Aid. And
That's what happens.
You know,
buy organic, you hear, buy organic. You know, go to the, what are those places called? The
Whole Foods. And
Whole Foods.
Do you know what the price of eggs is right now?
No. Like, what are you talking about?
So a carton of eggs, like $8 for a who can afford that?
I know.
And it's getting worse.
It's getting worse. This is what I'm saying. People are like, why do they eat that fast food? Because it's cheap.
It's cheap.
And they have mouths to feed.
They have mouths to feed.
But it is just a never-ending cycle of health issues.
Health issues.
Mental issues, and but you are helping stop that at the pass. I think is the saying. Like, you are getting to, but again, what you are doing for the mothers, what you are giving them, that empowerment is priceless.
Mm.
I feel like you are an angel on earth for doing that.
Thank you.
And
thank
so you. I, you know, my message is to any single mother out there who is. I see you doing your best every day.
Yes.
It is not easy.
Yes.
But here's someone who says you're not alone, and she can help you navigate. She can help you navigate that treacherous road, which is what it is. And people are not going to always understand you, why you make the decisions you make. But You love your kids. We know that. Keep going. Thank you. Do you have a message for the moms?
Stay encouraged. Support groups are really important. My children and I, we have been in therapy probably since they were three. Mm. So we've had life coaches, therapy. My daughters are married now. Well, one is married. They're marriage counseling. I have another daughter who's single here in Austin.
Yes.
She has a really high position, so her trauma always reactivates. And she has a life coach and a therapist. And, you know, get the tools that you need, right? Because although the things in our life didn't change, the trauma, we have tools that we use. Right, to help us. So we're no different when we get stressed out, but now we have tools. You know, we don't have to drink. We can call so-and-so, we can do this. And I think that's really important. I think because with other cultures, when you have money and access, right, you're getting divorced. You know, you have crazy stuff in your house, but guess what? It's like, you know, when you're my girlfriend, like Charlotte, you know, let's just go to the islands for the weekend. And she put some kiwi and just stretch out, you know, and breathe, right? You know, but we just have to go back to it.
Yes.
We just have to go to work, right?
Yep.
We just have to get up and still do it.
Yeah. Yep.
We don't have the tools. We don't have the access. We don't have the funds. We don't have the money. So we got to keep all this stuff in, you know, and talk and not talk about it.
Because we're trying
to be perfect. I talk about everything.
Yes.
I talk about the bad boyfriends, the bad relationships.
Yes.
You know, my kids know it. My grandkids know it.
Yes.
My grandson, 24, called me about 2 months ago, 11 o'clock at night.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, 11 o'clock? I picked up the phone. His name is Saheed. I'm like, are you in jail? Are you in jail? What's going on? He's like, no, Grandma, calm down. He's like, I got my friend on the phone. And he said, I'm going to hang up, and I need you to talk to my friend, Grandma. And he told his friend, you tell my grandma everything. Don't hold anything back.
Wow.
She can help you.
Wow.
Tell her. You're in good hands. I was like, oh!
That's remarkable.
Yeah. 24 years old, grandson.
But that says something about you and what he's seen you do.
Yeah.
That's remarkable.
Yeah.
You need to know that. And I will tonight be thinking about those ships. One with the holes in them, and
it's the perfect analogy.
It's a beautiful analogy.
To
understand that, and to have empathy.
Let's have empathy
for your neighbor who is single,
who's
struggling. There's a lot going on in that boat that we don't know.
Right, because the opportunities are there, but if there's no equity, we can't gain access to the opportunities.
Right. And as we see the way the nation is headed in social areas.
Oh, social.
If we keep pulling back and going back to where we were, I mean, all the work that's been done to sort of empower marginalized groups or groups that didn't get a head start, we're going backward.
Oh, yeah,
so
we are.
So keep that in mind.
Yeah.
And then vote the right way. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me. For being here. You're a ball of energy. You are a delight.
Thank you,
and
Charlotte.
I thank you for everything that you are doing for the women of the city.
Thank you.
We love you
for having me.
Yes. We'll see you on the next episode of Brainstorm Black.
Yes, can't wait.